All right.
Don't get quiet now. We can just started. So let's just give the Lord some praise. Now that we've been opened up, our hearts have been opened up. We've gone through the tribe of Judah, and we're entering into the gates. Amen. We're ready. We're ready for the word. If you have your Bibles, open them to Matthew 6, 16. Thank you. All right. Matthew 6:16. All right. It says, do not store up yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. Where are you putting your treasures? What are devil's a liar, amen? And I'm serious. We got to go through all 8 mics. We'll go through all 8 mics. I've seen worse, okay? Check. Shoot, I got a loud voice. You see how it cracks? That's from being loud. Amen. I know greater is he that is in me than that is in the world. So we're saying, do not store up your treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy it, and where thieves break in and steal. If that's where your treasures are, you can lose them like this. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. Where your treasure is, there will be your heart. So where is your treasure? Is your treasure in God? Is your treasure in your money? Is your treasure in your relationship? Is your boyfriend more important than God? Is your girlfriend more important than God? Is that who your treasure is? Well, you're in for a hard time, because that treasure could be gone tomorrow, whether they walk away or God takes them away. And if your treasure is in money, think of the prodigal son. He complained. He cried. He said, I don't want to be the second brother. I'm tired of being the least. Man, nothing works out for me. And he was growing up pretty well in a pretty rich house. But it doesn't matter what your real circumstances are, because there's an author of deception, the father of lies, that creeps into our minds, and we begin to see things in a different way than what they are. And he felt he wanted his money, and he wanted to just go and be his own God, so to speak. Let me decide what goes on. And that's what he did, and we know what happened. He's all his money was gone. He drank it away, bought it away, and ended up eating with the pigs, actually. Eating the slop with the pigs. So when he got there, then he's looking back and only wished he could be back where he was before. Amen? But the problem is, it wasn't too late for him. Because God doesn't give up on us. God takes us back, and that's the whole story of the prodigal son. He bought a deception. He bought a lie. And in his mind, he was believing his father would not take him back. He was believing that they'll never accept him. We need to be sure that we're hearing the right voice. We need to be sure we're storing up our treasures where they should be stored up. We need to be sure what our banner is. What does your banner say? We all raise a banner, and I don't mean literally putting up a sign and say, I serve God. That's not the banner I'm talking about. The banner I'm talking about is the banner of your life. What does your life say about you? And I'm not talking about what you do for a living or what you don't do for a living or what your hobbies are or anything like that. The only thing we really got is who we are. That's the one thing that cannot be taken from us. And that's the one thing God is trying to work in us, our character. God is trying to develop our character so that that's the one thing that will help us to succeed is our character. When everything else is gone and stripped away, who am I? Who am I? Who am I in the midst of the storm? Do I throw it all up in the air and run? Or do I have enough character to stay and fight and raise a banner that says, I trust and believe in the Lord. And this too shall pass, and I'm going to get through this, and I'm going to walk through the fire, and I'm not going to even get singed. Fire's going to come. Are we willing to walk through it? Here's the thing. It costs to raise a banner. Raising a banner is never free. It costs to take even a small hill as much as a large. Do you remember that movie, We Were Soldiers? It's horrible. Horrible. They're taking that one stupid hill, and you just wonder why. Why? Because most of them all died. It was horrible. It costs to have freedom. It costs to serve the Lord. It has a price. And are we willing to pay it? Are we willing to raise our banner even in the midst of adversity? Because I know a lot of times we just feel like, no, I don't want to raise my banner. And we begin to think things like, I had it better before I knew the Lord. And tell me, what day was that? The day you wanted to die, or the day you overdosed, or the day that you were so drunk you didn't know where you live? What day was it better? Because the father of lies begins to speak in our weakest moments, but in our weakness, he's made strong. What keeps us from raising a standard? What keeps us from doing what is right to do? Being people of good character, regardless. This is my word, okay? Regardless. What keeps us from being good to people, regardless if they're good to us? What keeps us from treating people like you would want to be treated, even if they're not treating you that way? There's a cost. There's a cost to be a light in this world. There's a cost to be different. There's a cost that has to be paid. And the paying could be persecution. Well, who do you think you are? Not that you're in church. I don't think I'm anybody. I'm just trying to love you. That's all, right? But people don't get that. But if they can motivate you to step out of that, then your testimony is lost. Everything you were trying to accomplish just went down the drain. But if we can hold steady, if we can keep our banners raised, if we can hire the standard that we live by, if we don't give in to the father of lies, which might say, don't let him disrespect you like that. And what do? Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you can't talk to me like that. It costs. Kenya, it costs to raise the standard. It costs to be a light in a very, very, very dark world. If you want people to see, not that you attend church, but that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Church ain't gonna do it, but a relationship with him will. When you can hear the Holy Spirit speaking to you, saying, turn the other cheek, but you push the fist. And then there's the but. I say, get rid of but. And replace it with regardless. You might have to swallow your pride. Jesus had to swallow a lot more. He had to swallow and he had to go through a lot more than we could ever imagine going through for us, for the cause of humanity. Now, what is humanity willing to do for the cause of Christ? Oh, y'all got quiet on me. Now I'm scared. What keeps us from raising a standard? Sin. Sin keeps us from raising a standard. Unrepented, unconfessed sin. Unrelenting sin stops the church from being who they need to be. Because you don't want to raise your standard because you believe that you have sinned and now you can't. And if people know, and oh my goodness, it's a dirty mess. But that's why there's Jesus. You see, it's not that we make mistakes, because we have Jesus to turn to and to ask for forgiveness. The problem comes when we move there, we live there. Sin becomes part of our lives because we don't confess it, we don't repent from it, we don't turn away from it. We just become comfortable with it. And it's hard to raise a standard when there's so much sin in our lives, unrepented sin. Don't let the devil fool you. Don't let him confuse you that you're not worthy to raise a standard, that you have to get somewhere before you can raise a standard, that you have to be somebody before you can raise the standard. I'm telling you, if you're born again, if you've accepted Christ in your life, raise the standard. And when you make a mistake, repent. Don't let the devil grab a foothold in your life. Don't open the door for him. We have more control than you think. Unrepented sin scatters the saints of God. It confuses us. It makes us weak. It makes us not of one mind. You see, when we come together in unity of one mind, one body, one God, we can do some major damage. We can take over communities. We can take over cities. We can do so much. What causes us to go into parks that no one else will go in? God. Somebody came and got me. Why won't I go and get somebody else? The door didn't shut the minute I got in. There's so much more. There's people just like me, just like you, that are thinking of dying today because nobody's reached them. Nobody's gone to those places that even the police won't go. We have to be different than the world. You can probably point to the place where you became, when you surrendered your life to God. But I bet you can also point to the place where you may have started drinking from the old well of religion instead of that relationship with God. Now listen to me. There's a difference. There's a huge difference. And how do you know you're drinking from the old well instead of the fresh water? By your attitude, where you were so pumped up about God, you are excited. You would tell anybody, look what God's done in my life. Can you believe this? And then after time passes, something happens. You begin to let the little foxes come in. And those little foxes don't just eat the leaves. They take the whole vine. But they're just little foxes. Just a little sin. It's not big. It's just little. I ain't killed nobody today. I ain't smoked no crack today. I just cussed somebody out. But they deserved it. No, regardless. That's what I'm saying. Be careful. Be careful what well you're drinking from. Don't buy the talk that you're giving, okay? Don't buy your own lies, okay? Be careful where you're drinking and how you know what well. By what you're thinking. What are you thinking? What are you thinking? It's the difference between servanthood and servitude. Servitude is getting a job done. Servitude is doing it from your heart unto God. And we can slip back and forth. But the key is to raise a banner and repent when we see we're doing it. And we know we're doing it by what's coming out of our mouth. Don't accept it. Don't take it on. Don't own that, because that's not you. That's the old you. The new you is different. The new you serves Christ. And all you have to do is turn away from what you know is wrong and listen to that voice inside of you saying, repent, 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 repent. And it's loud, but it won't stay loud forever. Little foxes will muffle it. You can point to the place where you stop loving and criticizing. You can, where you stop praying. Where you thought, I'll let somebody else do it. That's a pastor's job. Let her pray. I am, whether I want to or not. Listen to me, people. It has nothing to do. I'm no different than you. I don't have this overwhelming desire every moment of my life to get down on my knees and pray. But I know what moves the hand of God and what will keep me grounded and will help me to raise my banner, to raise my standard, what will help you to improve your lives. I'm responsible for myself and for my community. So I pray regardless. Regardless. God don't need my feelings. He needs my obedience. He don't need me to say, oh, God, I just really feel like praying today. He didn't say that. He said, pray. I don't think Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane had all this positive emotion praying for God to take this cup. He was so anxious that it said he bled blood. But he still did it. Regardless. Because that's how we raise a standard. That's how we raise our banner. That's how people know who we are. What is sin? Sin is the cut of a knife across a victim's face. Sin is the fear of somebody in their scream. Sin is the hollowness of an empty stomach. Because there's no reason for that. Not in this world. Sin is the snobbery of pride. Sin is the clutch of cancer. Sin is sin is murder. Sin is a clamor of war. We were talking yesterday in discipleship about war and how a Christian goes to war and how you're obedient to God when the Ten Commandments say don't kill. And I'm saying you have to be responsible for your own life. But every sin has a consequence. So if you feel you got to be a part of this war, then you be a part. But just know you're going to live with the consequence, which may be nightmares the rest of your life. There's consequence. I'm not telling anybody not to do anything because we're free. Everything is permissible, but everything is not profitable. We're not in bondage. I used to be in bondage to hate, to my drugs, to my attitudes. But then I found Christ. And it's not that I can't do drugs. I can do as much drugs as I want. I don't want to. Drink all you want. Get liver cancer. Cirrhosis. It's not profitable for you. It'll destroy your relationships. Be ready to pay the consequence. You're free. But how is it that you want to live? I want to live the way I'm living. I never want to go back. I never want to feel what I used to feel. And you know, the enemy can creep in because he's the author of lies. And he can begin to speak to you and convince you. But you got to take control of that. You need to know that I bind you, Satan, in the name of Jesus. You have no authority over this. Sin is the helplessness of divorce. Sin is epidemic AIDS. Sin is wealth in the pocket of abortionists. People making money over dying babies. Not only killing babies, but then selling their parts. What have we come to where we will take a fetus and take its liver or whatever part out and then sell it for big money? Don't tell me you're trying to help somebody. If you were, you'd just give it to them. We're living in the end times. And there's some really shifty stuff happening. Stuff that there's a dark world out there that probably most of us don't even know. We haven't got to that realm of darkness. I feel in my past I've peeked in on that realm and it scared me. I couldn't believe that people are actually like this. Sin is fear of the past, fear of the present, fear of the future. A sob of a child in a bedroom being beaten or abused. It's like this. We were meant to fly. We were meant to be something. we were meant to achieve. We were meant to be successful. But most of us didn't know it. There's a story of a farmer who found an eagle, a baby eagle, and took it home to his chicken coop. And he raised up this eagle in the chicken coop. And so the eagle did what the chickens did. Okay? He never flew away. He didn't know he could fly. He's doing what the people around him, what the birds around him are doing. If they're drinking, I'm drinking. If they're smoking, I'm smoking. This eagle pecked from the ground with the chickens, eating little scraps. And I've seen chickens eat some nasty stuff. Nasty. I don't know. I'll tell you. When I was in Africa, I was on an elephant. You know, elephants can really dump, right? And there was a chicken on front of us in a pile of this dump, pecking through it because there was a kernel of corn in it. How low can you go? How low? Sounds like the prodigal son slopping in the mud with the pigs. That's what this eagle was doing with the chickens. It didn't know it could fly. It didn't know it was the greatest bird on earth. It just pecked around. And then somebody came and said, I don't believe this eagle is just a chicken. So he tried to get the eagle to fly, and it wouldn't fly. He tried again, it wouldn't fly, but then he realized that eagle's not going to fly being around his circumstances, being around those other chickens. So he removed the eagle from the other chickens. And when he removed them from the other chickens and put them in a place and put the farmer over on a hill, that eagle started to fly. Because somebody bothered to come and to tell it the truth. You're not a chicken that's looking through the dung to get a piece of corn. You're an eagle. You can have whatever you want. You can soar the earth. I feel like that's us. I feel like I was that eagle slopping in the mud, doing what the people around me were doing. They were smoking drugs. They were shooting heroin. They were drinking. And I didn't even think about getting out because I didn't think I could get out. I didn't think I could fly because I tried for so long. I thought I could, but they come to the place where you just give up and accept your lot in life. Once a junkie, always a junkie, and you just stay there. I got news for you. Somebody came into my chicken coop and saw me in there, and they picked me out of it, and they said, you can fly, and they put me up, and they tossed me out, and I began to fly, and I put away the drugs, and I put away the hate, and I put away the sin. Once a junkie, today a reverend. Don't let the world hold you down. You know, the minute you try to get out, even your own family will clutch at your feet. It's like crabs in the crab bucket. Don't have to put a lid on it, because as soon as one's creeping out, one other one will pull it back. We got to learn to soar with the eagles, because that's what God designed for us. He has a plan and a purpose. He wants to prosper us. He doesn't want us eating a piece of corn out of a mountain of dung. He has so much better. He's not giving us crumbs. He's trying to give us a feast. But we keep saying, I can't. Maybe you're in a really bad place today. Maybe you're parched and empty. Maybe you feel like you're dying. I know I can feel like that. But I know truth, and I have to fight my way out. Because I'm a responsible person that's responsible for people, and I have a lot to live for. And so, no, I'm not going to take my life. You can lie to me all you want, devil. Because I'm not buying it anymore. I'm not a chicken anymore. I'm an eagle. Don't think the devil's going to go away because you accepted Christ. He's going to come at you harder. Don't ask, why do I still feel like this? Just stand up and raise a banner. He's still roaming the earth to see who he can devour. And that includes the saints. I should say especially the saints. You don't need to worry about the people in the world. They're doing enough damage themselves. Maybe your relationship is dying. Your marriage. Maybe all your plans and hopes. Maybe your dreams feel like they're shattered. They're not. That's the author of lives working at it. Because the only way out is to repent. Change your season. Change your mind. Change your actions. Change your direction. Change your character. Let God raise you up. Matthew 6:33 says this. Don't seek all the things of the world, because none of that will keep you. None of that will hold you. Some of the most miserable people I know are millionaires. So money doesn't do it. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, then shall be added unto you. Why then? Because then you'll have the Holy Spirit in you, so that you can walk by the Spirit and know what to do with the wealth that he gives you. Instead of squandering it like the prodigal son. You see, before Christ, we don't know what to do with money. What did we do? You don't even want to talk about it. It's heartbreaking. The amount of money we threw away for nothing. Why would we do this? To show God we love him. That who we give our rights to. When we get angry, when we want to retaliate, why would we not slap them back? Because who owns you? Who owns you? You got to give your rights to God. Let God work it out. Let God be the judge. Let God be the one who gets the vengeance. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. You don't have to worry about it. He's telling you to raise a banner. Because that's the only way our situations, our circumstances around us can change. Or we can act just like them. And go around the mulberry bush again. Who owns your car? You gave it to God? Well, give him the title so you can't pick it up whenever you want. Don't just give him the car. Give him the title. There's a huge difference. And God is the final authority. We serve an awesome God. And that awesome God is trying to raise us up. Even though we're stubborn. Even though we've learned to act like chickens. And we don't realize how magnificent we are. And when we do get a glimmer of hope to step out, fear grips your heart. What if? No, what if? No, what if? I bleed the blood of Jesus over my mind. Give me the mind of Christ so I can push forward. Life is not a life of chance. Don't think that, oh, I just have bad luck. Life is choice. It's choice. And we live out the repercussions of our choices. Turn it around. You don't like the way it's going? Turn it around. You're not stuck. You're an eagle. You can fly. We're going to close. This room is filled with powerful people. And I can choose to be in any room I want to be in. And I choose this room. I don't like preaching at other churches. I don't want to go. I'm not going. Actually, I was supposed to be somewhere else today. Because I choose to preach to this room. Because this is the room that is filled with eagles that are going to fly. I made my husband go. That's how we do it. We're a team. That's how we can be in two places at the same time. And why are we doing all this? Because we love God. And because we know he's coming back, and he's coming back for his bride. Those who have confessed him as Lord and Savior. Those who have paid a price. Those who counted the cost. You may be here today and say, Pastor, I'm not sure. I don't know if I'm part of that. I don't know if I paid the price. I don't know if I've gone through the cost. You can fix that. Right here, right now, today. Don't leave here unsure of where you'll spend eternity. Know where you'll spend it. So bow your heads with me. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, I want to know that I know that I know that I am right with God. If that's you, just slip up your hand wherever you are. If you say, I need God, pray for me, Pastor. Pray for me. Pray for me. Let's stand to our feet. And those of you that raised your hand, just come and gather here because it's a simple prayer. I prayed it years ago. And I hardly knew what I'm saying. But God heard it. Maybe the people that asked me to pray didn't hear it, but God heard it. And that's all that needs to hear it. I want to be right. want to walk and raise a banner. I'm tired of being in a chicken coop. I want to fly. And I want to put the devil where he belongs, out of my life. Only God in the future will throw him into the pit of fire. But as long as he's here roaming the earth, we got to be equipped. We got to take control. It's choice. We're going to pray in just a minute. Listen to these words. Up your hands. Let's pray this prayer together. Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my unbelief. Forgive me for not raising a banner. I repent today. I believe you're real. Come into my life. Teach me your word. Help me to stand. Let no weapon formed against me prosper, because I know I can do all things through Christ Jesus. Today I can fly in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen.